Welcome back to watching the Urban Debate with Mirror Now, Faye D'Souza. Thank you for joining us. So we're looking again at the approval the cabinet has given for the 10% quota for people who fall into the economic weaker section of society. Now, this has been tabled before the Lok Sabha, and various political parties have pledged their support to the bill, including those staunch in opposition of the current government, like the TMC and the NCP so far. Questions have been raised in Lok Sabha that haven't been answered. Questions like how will this be implemented? Will it be included in the ninth schedule? Will it be opposed or will it be struck down by the Supreme Court? And what kind of time frame has been offered to Parliament to discuss something so complicated? We understand that the Congress has asked for the entire bill to be referred to a joint parliamentary committee, and the RJD so far has opposed the bill. Joining me on the show right now, Raman Malik with the BJP, Pallavi Sharma, spokesperson of the Congress, Aishwarya Bhati is an advocate with the Supreme Court, Manisha Priyam, political analyst, Ashutosh is a senior journalist, Vinay Tiwari, consulting editor of the Times Network. One of the questions we're going to ask in the next 1 hour is simply this. Like the Shiv Sena pointed out, during its time in Parliament, where are the jobs? Actually blamed as an ally of the government, blamed the government for bringing in demonetization and GST, causing a severe case of unemployment across the country, and now offering this quota to solve that problem. Will the quota that's being offered right now solve the employment problem and the jobs problem? Where are the jobs? That was a very important question asked by the Shiv Sena. I'm going to open this for my panel right now, and we'll keep dipping back into Lok Sabha as the conversation continues in Lok Sabha as well. I want to start with Vinay Tiwari. Vinay, good evening. Very interesting to see parties in opposition of the government now come on board. Is it because they really have no choice?
Yes, I mean, it's the proverbial albatross that's been wrapped around the neck of every opposition party. I mean, however much they may cringe within themselves, and I'm sure they're cringing, the fact of the matter is that none of them can publicly to be seen to be opposing it. And I think this is part of the vote bank politics or literal politics that every party has practiced, including now the BJP.
Yes.
And in many ways, what has happened yesterday when the government leaked the intention to introduce the bill today was pretty much the beginning of the election campaign. It's not so much a move to change a section of society. This is really the election manifesto promise. It's like a election campaign. So the BJP has started its election campaigning by simply bringing in this bill. And the every other party for once are now just found, I mean, they're almost responding to them. I mean, they found themselves on the back foot. There was initial confusion. You could clearly see that the parties weren't sure on how to react to it. Mm-hmm. Some of them have started figuring out how to react to this now. The RJD, for instance, has come out with a theory. So have, for instance, the couple of other opposition parties as well. But definitely, it's something that they can't seem to be opposing.
Well, Manisha Priyam, political analyst. Manisha ji, the interesting part is that a lot of these parties actually asked valid questions but then supported the bill. From what we understand, the Aam Aadmi Party now say this is BJP's jumla, but we're supporting the bill. We had other parties ask some very valid questions but didn't stand in the way of the bill. Is this now, like Vinay described, a sort of a political catch-22 for all of these parties? Because none of them have the time to have their questions answered.
So it's still not a political catch-22. Remember, putting this bill on the floor of the parliament, on the Lok Sabha essentially, it's still not anywhere close to implementation, because it is doing something so de novo, so tabula rasa, that the lists for upper castes do not exist as a legal entity. We understand what is upper caste sociologically, or we understand it ideologically. What we do have in India is a list of scheduled castes, a list of scheduled tribes. These are constitutionally ordained. And then we have the other backward castes that are statewide listing. What we do not have is a list of upper castes. So I think sui generis first to generate that list. On top of that, to have a criteria of economic backwardness. Remember, economic backwardness is a criteria that has been used, for example, by taking over from the public distribution system, the BPL criteria. But the BPL criteria itself is something that has received a lot of criticism, and we do not have a BPL survey for urban areas. So the economic criteria as of now has not been implemented pan-India on similar or measurable scales, which is pan-India in character. So by itself, having an upper caste list and having it cross-tabbed with something which is an economic criteria, that itself is a nightmare. That itself is something that has not been done up until now. So even before you can think of the legislature, you can think of anything else. If you simply think of what this bill intends to do, you will realize that before any Catch-22, it's whopped up in wool. It's at best a statement of intention right now. On intentions, whether political parties are saying that we need to recognize that there could be people who are economically very poor and they could belong to an upper caste, and whether we think we should have reservation for them or not. So at this point of time, the parliament will at best resolve or try and answer a hypothetical question. It's nowhere close to the implementation. And of course, you are aware of what will happen if the legislative intent is taken to court. Whether that stands scrutiny or not is another, it's a can of worms. It's very woolly. We need to understand that in a different frame. But as of now, very difficult to think of how the implementability of this thing is going to be done.
Well, here's what we can do, though, considering we are not political parties and we have no election to win. We can ask the difficult questions that they're not asking or not answering in the legislature, which is what we ideally should have been happening in Lok Sabha today. So, Vinay, I'm actually going to give everybody an opportunity on the panel to ask questions about this bill. Hopefully, Raman Malik will be able to offer us some answers. He's here representing the BJP. If I were to ask you, and you've spent the entire day listening to what's happening in Parliament and making notes, what, according to you, is the most glaring, lack of clarity or the question that you would like to ask the government at this
point?
Well,
there are certain technical and legal clarities that, of course, we would need. There are, of course, the larger issues of where are the jobs. Just one point that Manisha mentioned, actually, I mean, they haven't exactly talked about caste at all. They're talking about economic weaker class that covers everybody. In fact, if you ask me, for me, the bigger problem in this particular bill is this. If you go by their definition of who qualifies for this, and this is government's own data, this is not my data, this is government's. The NABARD's financial survey, inclusion survey that came out in 16-17, 99% of rural households will qualify for that, because that's the according to the cutoff that the government is proposing. Similarly, if you see the financial inclusion survey, 86% of the people actually qualify for that in the rural areas. So this is a promise which covers everybody. So in many ways, it just becomes redundant. You have such a wide ambit of definition of economic weaker class that actually, technically, you will be earning 65,000 rupees a month to qualify for this. Now, that in itself is as absurd as you can think. I mean, this is certainly not, this is so wide in its interpretation.
So effectively, you have about roughly 85-90% of the population competing for that 10% rest,
so
which is what they were doing anyway.
They were doing anyway, right? They were already part of that general quota that was existing outside of the 50%.
So let me take that question to Raman Malik. And Raman Malik, I'm going to bring you questions of every one of our panel members. 95% of the population, or more than 85% at least, will be competing for this 10% category that the government is offering. Effectively, this is what the general category is doing already. So how does this make sense? How is this a new reservation? How is it a reservation at all?
It says these criteria are for family income, not for individuals. Plus, if this is not, then how are you going to explain it? What we have taken is nothing which is new. These limits are there in existence in some other categories. But then, what I find a little surprising is that this is a move in the positive direction. This is towards taking care of the poor in our society. Now, apparently, a lot of people whose identity is based on doing casteist politics, vote bank politics of various sorts, they are now getting a little too disturbed. Now they're talking about what is my grandchild going to be when he or she grows up. Boss, you must figure out what are you going to do today. So let's start addressing the problem of today. We are giving a reservation. We have made a provision. There was 2004 manifesto of Congress, 2009, 2014. They've been talking on all of this, but never they could take the initiative to go forward and do something about it. Once you sit down in the parliament, you must debate, you must decide, you must do things. There are always avenues to talk about things.
Okay,
But at
so
least
Raman
there
Malik,
should be
so
some
fair enough.
step in
Let
the
me ask
right
you this
direction.
question then. Let
And
me ask you
when
this
you take
question.
a step in the right direction, there is problem with people who have been feeding on wrong.
Okay, let me ask you this question. You're absolutely right that there must be discussion in Parliament. So how is it fair then for the government to offer Parliament about 24 hours worth of discussion to pass something so complicated? First question. Second question, you did say that the other parties weren't able to do it, and you're right, and now you've been able to do it. Could you tell us, according to the government's calculation of the definition for economically weaker, how many households, you said family incomes, how many households fall under this category in India right now?
See, I may not have the figures as per right now, and there would be some calculations required and whatever things, I would study that. But let me tell
so
you
does the
something
government
very
have the
interesting
figures?
which happened in today in Parliament. No, I'll tell you. Apparently, a gentleman who holds a very important position in the opposition, who may be covered under the reservation, who is accused or let's say who is supposedly holding multi-thousand crores of property and assets, says, isko agle session mein kar dete hain, agle session mein.
Mr. Raman Malik.
Why? There was another person from the benches who says, we are Shudras, we have been given so much of treasury in the past century. We must get it, but the others should not.
No,
they
Mr.
have
Malik,
Mudra Yojana, they
Malik,
have all
Mr.
these
Malik,
other
the
yojanas,
audience has already
which are there
seen
for
what happened in Parliament.
Weaker.
We in fact carried
is
it live
that
on the channel. My
those
question
yojanas,
to you,
is that
you
those
have not answered.
Take away.
Has
take
the government
away
done
from
a survey to find out how many households qualify for this,
the
for this reservation? Do you know how many people
Faye,
will be competing
please,
for your 10%?
This is a very important question.
No, it's not. You
are very important. Faye, this is very important.
Okay,
these
what
two points
important?
Are very important. Do the Mudra Yojana, the Ayushman, the Ujwala, do they take a differentiation in terms to whether somebody is already covered under some reservation or not? Are they specific to caste or creed? No, they are not. In the same manner, I would also like to bring to your attention that this bill does not say that you should be a Hindu, you should be a Muslim, you should be a Sikh, or you should be a Christian. Does it say so?
Okay, so Raman Malik, my question to
Must
you was,
have a inclusive
does the government
India
know,
going sabka saath, sabka vikas?
Does the government know how many households will fall under this category of economically weaker as described under this bill?
I suppose there are a sizable number which are there and this would be addressed. Why not? What is the problem in it?
So you don't know. All right. Ashutoshji, do you have a question for the government of India on this bill?
See, I think, Faye, the real analysis has not been done about it. And I just want to extend the argument. If 85% of the population will be now competing for the 10% of the reservation, the rest 15% will be competing for the 41% of the reservation. Do you understand what I'm saying? Mm. I'm saying the fundamentals of the reservation is that once you avail the facility of reservation, you are not supposed to compete for the rest. Like if SC, ST or the backward class, if they are availing a facility under the reservation category, they cannot compete for the general category.
How
so it has been very clearly designed to help upper caste and upper class. Only if, because 85% of the population is going to qualify for this reservation, if they apply reservation under this category, they automatically gets debarred for the general category. I'm not saying.
Okay.
This is Supreme Court order under DIPA EV judgment it has been given. Even the Gujarat High Court has given the judgment. So, it is only benefiting 15% of the population. Because now it has become easier for the 15% population which falls under the category of general, they will be getting the more pie into the 40% reservation. So it's a very diabolical thing. This is going to create a greater social crisis in future.
Do you agree, Vinay?
Why I'm saying so?
One second. Do you agree that there is a lack of perhaps study or a lack of clarity?
Sir, I'll give you another.
No. One second, Raman Malikar.
Legally, Ashutosh is right. Once you claim, once you are part of a category as defined as a reserved category, you can't claim benefits under the general category. So that legally is absolutely correct. I mean, that's how it will be. If I today claim to be economically weaker and I enjoy the benefit of reservation, I'm out of the general category completely. So those remaining people, according to Ashutosh, will get further marginalized and it will create new social tensions, some tensions which perhaps don't exist currently.
All right, Raman Malik, respond, please. Go ahead.
So, Faye. So, how many number of people from these reserve category would fall below this thing? When they talk about 85% of population getting into it and all those figures that they are giving, they are self-defeating in their arguments. When they talk about that, 85% of population would come under this, correct? Now, if you take out your own argument and say the ones who's already availing reservations would not be given, then what is the population that goes out? How much is remaining? Will those get or not? So the point here is, so
shouldn't that data be available for the
people
government?
People like him do self goals every now and then. Fair. They're as good as Rahul Gandhi.
No. So political rhetoric aside, Raman Malik, the data you just asked for, the government should have had ready, and we should have been able to analyze it today. But like you said, the data is not available. Ashutosh, do you want to respond to that?
Hey, apparently, I saw you very seriously saying this. Shows on fuel price high. Hey, when the prices went down, you were not doing shows on it.
No, one second, Raman Malik.
That is convenience.
One second.
So let's not get into rhetoric of convenience. Hey. Let's get into the actual issue.
Okay.
People don't look to your TV channel for statistics. They look for the direction.
And the directions we like to give with statistics. Ashutosh, go ahead, please.
And Faye, and you should realize that the 14% of the Muslim population, which we are not getting any reservation of any kind, now they will be also added. That is around more than 20 crores. Then the Christians, which were also not getting reservation, they will also get accommodated in this. So what does it mean? That almost 90% of the general category will be only getting 10%, and the 10% who are already affluent and who are already very well off, they will be getting, they will be competing for the 40%. You know, you understand what I'm saying? I'm saying that this has become life much more easier for the people who are competing.
Ashutosh, you are completely wrong.
And
okay,
who are well
okay,
off.
So let me get your legal point of view.
With all less right, number right. of people.
Okay.
They will be competing with a less number of the people. So if you add the Muslim population, if you add the Christian population,
these people
if you
in the
add
general
85% of the urban poor, as per defined by the government by 8 lakhs.
All right, gentlemen,
so
one
that means, that means, that okay. means, that means,
There is hardly any space for the poor. Reservation.
Okay, all right. I want to bring in Aishwarya Bhatti. She's an advocate with the Supreme Court. Gentlemen,
why?
Please. One second. We've heard you both out. Aishwarya, if you could just, do you, A, first of all, agree with Ashutosh's hypothesis? And do you have a question legally for the government on this matter? Raman Malik, you'd want to listen to this question, please. Aishwarya Bhatti, please, go ahead.
Yeah, I do want to clarify. I think factually we are not proceeding in the right direction.
Okay.
I will not agree with Ashutosh ji because the principles of reservation are very, very clear that if somebody is claiming reservation, then if he is above the merit of that reservation, same is the case for SC, ST and OBC also. So if the candidates of SC, ST, OBC fall above the merit, above the threshold, then they are treated as general candidates. And only after the others who are below that threshold are treated here, unless they have already taken any benefit of reservation. That is the concept of and principle of the reservation. So it's not like this will be a watertight compartment where we will be putting 90% of the population just trying to vie for 10% of the seats. So that is not how reservation works legally. Secondly, I also want to, another factual error that we are making is that this 8 lakh income threshold for the household, that's not the complete story. In fact, the complete story is that financial threshold will be something that the states will decide on the basis of the data that is available with the state. So this is what the discussion that we have heard today and the bill that has been presented is specifically on the amendment of the Constitution and specifically with regard to Article 15 and Article 16 of the Constitution. We will also have to understand how the journey of reservation has been in our Constitution. See, when we started off, there was reservation only for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe when our Constitution was first enacted. And that too was not for an unlimited period, it was for a limited period. Thereafter, after 3-4 decades, OBC reservation was added. Of course, that SC-ST reservation continued because the time was increased every now and then, and it has continued for 70 years. But I must also remind you of one thing that even Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar had highlighted at that time, that we should not remain satisfied with just political democracy. We have to work hard to get social and economical democracy and equality too. So I think economic parameter, now we already have the creamy layer concept in the existing reservation. That is essentially also an economic criteria. Okay. So economic criteria, and this covers all castes, creed and community and religions who are not covered in the existing reservation. So it is, I think, economic criteria, introducing economic criteria as the basis for reservation is a very, very positive step.
Aishwarya Bhatti, quick question to you as well. The finance minister argued that this bill needn't be taken to the state assemblies and it needn't be ratified by 50% of the state assemblies. Now, legally, do you agree with his conclusion?
I need to add here, Faye. I need to add something
here, Article 368 of the Constitution. After I heard that, Article 368 of the Constitution.
Faye, can I come in,
one
please?
Second, madam, can I just complete?
No, let her finish.
Article
368 and then I'll bring
of
the others,
Constitution very specifically says that when amendment is to be made in Part 3 of the Constitution, then you don't need. It's not necessary to go to the one half of the legislatures. Part 3 only contemplates 2/3 of the majority in both houses. So, Finance Minister is right in saying that. That's how the Constitution contemplates it.
All right, Manisha ji, go ahead.
See, the first thing is that, I need to tell my esteemed colleague who's come in before me, I think it was Aishwarya Bhatti ji, that, social and economic backwardness was the criteria envisaged in the Constitution for on the basis of which reservations were given. Over time, with due process in the Parliament, with exact vetting by the courts, somehow it got defined into caste-based backwardness. Now, as of now, we don't have a policy practice of giving reservations in jobs based on the criteria of economic backwardness. She is partly correct on saying that states have the socioeconomic caste census. But for example, if the UPSC were to mandate a list, which is a central list of economic backwardness, how would that be done? So there is much more homework needed than we try and understand it now. The BPL survey as it exists only for rural areas. For the urban areas, we don't really have criteria of economic backwardness as of now. If the government is in the hold of such data, the first disclosure that is required is that this data be made public.
Yes.
And what madam needs to understand from our point of view, we work on the economic policy domains. What needs to be understood is that in India, we've had poverty line measures where discussions on economic backwardness have happened. And whenever we try and take the poverty line to a lower level, we find that there's so much clustering around it, meaning thereby that there is too much concentration of the poor and the marginal on any economic line. So
right.
The economic data, therefore, make it very difficult to estimate as to what is it that the numbers that we are serving. Lastly, I would submit that the economic criteria of backwardness that has been used in policies under now has been for universal coverage measures. For example, economically backward under such and such, universally give such and such. But if you are trying to match a criteria of economic backwardness with a narrow tunnel of 500, 700 jobs to be divided in various types, I can't really see how the overlap and mapping will happen. Therefore, very difficult to understand how the economic criteria will be defined in a pan-India sort of measure, because these data, as they exist on the socio-economic caste census, have not been disclosed in the public domain and are not freely available. The urban areas do not have BPL measures, and wherever economic criteria of backwardness has been used, it's been used for distribution of universal public goods, which are non-rivalrous in character, and not to give someone a job and deny the others that. So it's going to be a plethora task to for policymakers to see. And one day in the parliament, certainly applying the guillotine on a debate and putting it to vote is not enough to be able to do this.
All right, so I want to bring in the opposition now. Pallavi Sharma of the Congress is with us. Pallavi ji, we had the finance minister argue that the Congress included this as part of your manifesto in the previous election, and the BJP has managed to pull through something that you didn't. What is your response to that?
Good evening, Faye. Good evening to all the panelists. First, I just want to highlight the deviousness of the BJP government. On the penultimate day, they decide to table this bill without consulting the opposition at all. Now, they've extended the parliament by one day. This is the height of their deviousness. Why are they in such a hurry if it's not a political gimmick or a political jumla? The Congress party stand is only this. Send it to a select committee. Why are you not sending it to a select committee? Let the select committee review whether even if the bill is feasible or not. The second point, yes, we had robbed in the economic weaker sections a quota in our 2014 manifesto. Yes, we did. But we would have acted in a more viable and feasible manner. We would have consulted stakeholders, unlike the BJP government that has totally, that has tabled this bill that is blistering with legal complications as of date. I'll tell you one legal complication. They say the criteria would be 8 lakh per annum. And I was just hearing Ms. Aishwarya Bhati say that 90% people, we are not going to bring in 90% of people under this quota. Madam, as per your government's criteria, you will be bound to bring in this 90% people, because in our country, 3% of the people actually pay, 3% of the total population pays income tax. Can you give me the statistics, you or Raman Malik, how much of that 3% pays income tax in the slab of 8 lakh % per annum? 8 lakh % per annum is 67,000 rupees per month. You want to classify these people as economically weaker sections of the society? Will that be feasible? Then you'll end up indulging 90% or more of the population. Secondly, the second criteria is 5 hectare per land. 85% of farmers in our country have less than 5 hectares of land. So all those 85% farmers will also be robbed in this EWS criteria. Now my question, the Congress party's question is very simple. Right, we are all for this bill. We are for supporting quota on economically weaker sections. But the point is this, how will this create even one additional job? The truth is, you can extend quota on jobs, but that will not help in creating additional job in any manner whatsoever. You have lost 1 crore 10 lakh jobs in the preceding year only itself, in 2018. The unemployment rate is 7.3%, which is the lowest. There are 24 lakh vacant posts in government sectors. And you're talking about quota in jobs when there are no jobs at all.
Okay, Raman Malik will respond. Raman Malik, please respond.
It is a classical case of, Congress in action. Why I say so is, when we are talking about a subject which is reservation, and it is not a subject which is job creation. Job creation is a different subject which we can debate. And we can definitely talk about the self-employment and the various scheme that has happened.
Your reservation
at the same time,
based,
I would love to
sir,
understand
your reservation
that if
is
they
based
support,
on jobs and
if they
education,
support,
when there are
if
no jobs,
support
Faye, where will you
if
implement
support this
reservation?
Reservation
please,
that's why was Mr. Kharge
you
wanting to put it aside for the next session? Ma'am, the simple point is,
why are you
I will
in
give
such
you a data.
Rush, sir? Why do you want to...
And this is
on the
common
penultimate
sense.
Day,
I do not know whether, you will have it or not.
That on the penultimate day,
okay,
you decide
all right,
to table
I will give you a data.
Let me bring this back to the panelists who are not politicians. One second, Raman Malik.
You live in a fool's paradise.
All right.
And the paradise is owned by Rahul Gandhi.
Okay, Raman Malik, hang on. Raman Malik, hang on. Please keep the debate a little more.
You don't have the data.
All right, Raman Malik, here's my question for you. Now, do we have data on the number of government jobs that will come in this 10% category? So how many jobs are we talking about altogether? First question. Second question, the party president of the BJP said crores of young people will receive justice through this bill. So obviously we are talking about crores of young people. Do we know how many jobs are available for these crores of young people who will receive justice through this bill? So how many jobs are up for grabs for these crores of young people? And how many crores of young people? Raman Malik.
That is exactly what I said.
See, first and foremost, I would like to answer which you are trying to subdue. My answer to the Congress panelists and to you also is that you easily tend to forget around 5.5-6 crore mudra loans which have been given, which are generally having one more person employed. Where are those numbers going? Number one. Number two, the Shops and Establishment Act, where an amendment was done and a lot of people have started opening, rather than 6 hours, they started opening 10 to 12 hours of their shops. Okay. They are employing more people. Okay. Where is that employment? That is of no good use. What are you, the only job in the country is government jobs?
No, okay, so do I, yes, in fact, I'm not the one saying it. One second. Raman Malik, you just said, we are not having a discussion on job creation. We're having a discussion on reservation, right? So let's talk about reservation. One second, Raman Malik, calm down. You're the only one getting upset on this panel. Let's talk about reservation.
Why were you talking about jobs earlier?
So hang on, let me ask the question.
You were talking about jobs.
Hang on, let me ask the question. Raman Malik, take a deep breath and listen to the question. The question is about reservation for government jobs.
You have a glass of water,
so I want to understand how many government jobs are available under this 10% slab of reservation. How many candidates do we expect? And how many jobs will be available for them? Now, this is a question based on the bill, based on the statements from your party. I just want to understand the numbers.
This question is not based on the bill. This question is based on the intention to divert and set a narrative. But still, I will answer this. First of all, these people have the reservation in the educational field. So that is one angle of it.
Okay, do we know how many seats?
The second angle comes is the job. But we are at the same time creating more avenues for private sector jobs. And Faye, if you stop me from saying, I will still say this.
See.
If you do not consider private sector jobs as jobs, you should be in Doordarshan rather than Mirror Now.
Well, I'm not going to stop you from saying that, Raman Malik. I will tell you quite happily that I do consider private sector jobs as jobs. I have enjoyed a private sector job for my entire career. That is not the point. The point is we're discussing a reservation bill that specifically applies to government sector jobs.
And we will serve
it applies
the poor
to private sector education and government education. I would like to know how many seats we're talking about in both of those categories, but I'm afraid you might not have the numbers for that either. So, Vinay Tiwari, here's the problem. We know that the government doesn't have any sort of data on jobs. We've struggled with this on this channel for a year. We've only had anecdotal evidence on job creation, but like Raman Malik said, that's not what we're talking about. But if we're going to talk about crores of young people who will receive justice or nyaya from this particular bill, how many jobs available to you, these crores of people? There's no data on that either.
Look, however much Mr. Malik may get upset about it, the fact of the matter is that when you talk about reservation, reservation applies only to two kinds of people. One who are looking for jobs and the other who are looking for education, and which is a spelt out logic in the bill that was introduced today. All private educational institutes will have to implement this. So will the government. Government did it. Completely fair. The other half of the provision of the bill is for people seeking government jobs.
Yes.
Hence, the discussion has to be about jobs, because ultimately, the effectiveness of this scheme, and a wonderful scheme which the government has come up with through this bill, lies only when the government job is available. For me, which is why the absence of unemployment data, for instance, the fact that there are 24 lakh jobs between the states and the center which are still not filled, there are vacancies in the government job. The government vacancies today stand at nearly 24 lakhs simply because successive governments, not just this government, successive governments have been moving towards downsizing. They don't have enough money in the states to pay salaries to their employees, and everybody has been looking to reduce the number of employees. It's a difficult thing for most states.
Yes.
And hence, the number of existing vacancies is nearly 24 lakhs. You do have situations in the states where the government, like railways, for instance, advertised for nearly 85,000 jobs. The number of applicants ran into millions.
Yes.
That's the reality. Now, in a situation where the bill promises reservation, naturally the argument will come back to the point on, do we have enough jobs to provide for these youngsters who, as the party rightly say, will benefit from it. So how yes. much effective will that benefit be has to be correlated with this maths, otherwise there's no point.
And if we don't have that data like before us, is the bill premature?
No,
and is
you
the
don't
expectation
have to correlate with this matter, reason being that this is a provision. The provision is about a principle in operation. It is not principle in numbers. It is principle in operation.
Are you
so
satisfied?
Let's differentiate the fact.
Hey, can I
it
come
is
in,
a principle
please?
Operating mechanism. It is not the number juggling.
Hey, can I come in?
One second. Raman Malik, do you accept that we have a job crisis in this country right now?
I do not think we have an employment crisis per se.
What does that
in
mean?
This nation. We have opportunities and we are exploring opportunities.
Okay, all right. So let me open this
if
up to the rest
job
of the panel.
If the creation
at this point
is only limited to government jobs,
hey,
then
please?
We must turn
say
socialist.
10 seconds.
Okay, so one second. Pallavi, I see your hand up, but I want to bring in the other members of the panel
hey,
at this
can
point.
Can I ask just one question?
All right,
to
Pallavi,
Mr.
go
Raman
ahead.
Malik. 10 seconds. I just want to ask one question to Mr. Raman Malik. And the question is this. If there are no railway tracks, can you still run trains? The answer to it is no. Similarly, when there are no jobs, on what are you imposing reservation? Like I was just hearing the learned gentleman before say that there was an advertisement rolled out which said 50,000 people can apply. 50,000 vacancies were listed. Now, even if you give reservation, those 50,000 vacancies will continue to remain 50,000. They'll not increase. So you have to increase the scope of employment. You have to increase jobs. You have to give more job employment and employment to the youth of this country and then come up with the step of reservation. When there are no jobs, why are you imposing reservation?
Just one second. Let me bring in Manisha Priyam.
You,
just one second. Otherwise, it's going to turn into a Congress versus BJP thing. One second. Mr. Raman Malik,
seconds.
You will have to wait when I ask you to wait.
15 seconds.
No, 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 no. This 10 seconds, 15 seconds, you're taking over the debate. Manisha Priyam, one second. Could I speak with Manisha Priyam, please? Thank you. Manisha Priyam, here's my question. We currently find ourselves at a complete lack of data and lack of information. In your opinion, is this bill well thought out? Is it properly researched? Do we have the data, like Vinay said, to even assess what problem it's solving and whether or not it's going to work?
No. Government can, if it wants, it has the data. Remember, India has one of the best statistical systems in all of the developing countries with the National Sample Survey Organization. But you are aware that we haven't had thick rounds of employment unemployment data for a while. And given the fact that our employment or unemployment is largely in the informal sector, remember 90% jobs are in the informal sector. So we are just talking about that narrow slice anyways. The informal markets have been destroyed irreparably by some of the ill thought out measures of this government. As far as the formal market is concerned, you can come down to any of the states. I was in Jharkhand, I am in Bihar. Most of the teaching jobs are that of para teachers. The state of government of Jharkhand has not had a single employment of teachers in the last so many years. You look at the central universities, the number of vacancies that are there. So what is it that the central government is going to give out? For the UPSC itself, I've been informed yesterday that this time the vacancies are only about 500 jobs. They used to be of the order of 1,500 jobs. So even if one simple data of the number of IAS, IPS, IFS and forest service jobs that are being, and economic service jobs that are being advertised by the central government this year and in the last is put together, you will realize that all this statement making by the central government, remember, the central government is responsible only for the central government jobs that it will give out. What is it for? 2,000, 3,000 jobs, 4,000 jobs? And then you will realize the mockery of the situation. Now, once a central legislation of this kind is put in place without understanding what the economic backwardness criteria are on the ground for various states, what kind of poverty measures are we going to use, which are robust measures. Simply a government coming and saying 8 acres land, this, you know, they have to explain in the court of law if it goes there as to what is the rationale of backwardness, what kind of surveys have been done. These have to be established by argument. These have to be established by merit-based papers. All of that does not exist. So I'm appalled to see that you have a bill that comes in and that's claiming, at this point, it is at best a statement of intent, and worse, that if we match it up against the jobs on offer by the central government, you will realize that, you know, it's yes, just giving nothing and basically giving out political statements. That's what it is all about.
All right, an update for our viewers.
Yes, we made this promise. Why we didn't act on it in the last 5 years, we don't explain.
Yes, yeah. An update for our viewers. The bill is as of now supported by the TMC, the Shiv Sena, the TRS, the LJP, the BJP, the CPIM, the NCP and the SP. So Ashutosh, you know, some surprises there. Like we talked about at the beginning of the show, some staunch opposition. And this is perhaps the unfortunate part, because we've currently gathered a list full of questions that ought to be answered, to be fair, before anything is passed. But here we have political party after political party who, quite frankly, don't have the spine to stand up and ask the questions.
See, the political party will not ascend for the simple reason, because political party looking the fact that why the BJP government should get all the benefit for the reservation. Reservation in this country has always been very, very emotional issue. You remember when the Mandal Commission was implemented, then how many self-immolation took place in this country? And BJP was behind all that. So if all the opposition political parties, they are trying to support it, they know that BJP should not only get the benefit out of it. The two things which is very, very important. And all of these political parties know in their heart that this bill is not going to be implemented per se, because they know it will be challenging the Supreme Court. And once it is challenging the Supreme Court, the basic fundamental which was decided by the Indira Sahni judgment in 1992, that economic criteria cannot be the measure for the backwardness. It can only be educational and the social backwardness. So it will not stand the scrutiny of the Supreme Court. And the second point, which is again very important, is that the Supreme Court has already said you cannot have reservation more than 50%. The different states have given reservation. They have been scrapped by the Supreme Court or the respective courts. So the issue is the political party know in their heart that this will not be law. This is just to befool people just before the elections, knowing fully well that only the rich amongst the general category, they will get the benefit, and the poor will be victims at the end. And it will, and mark my word, this will lead to the social crisis in coming days and coming months.
Arun Jaitley clarified that.
Well, yes, that point that Ashutosh mentioned, Arun Jaitley clarified that. I mean, we don't know whether this clarification stands scrutiny in a constitution bench or not, but he did clarify, saying that the Supreme Court's orders meant that the 50% cap exists only if the reservation is caste-based. And if it is not caste-based, it's economic-based, then it doesn't apply. That's his interpretation.
Let me clarify this. The Supreme Court has not talked about this. Supreme Court has only talked that the reservation should not be above 50% per se. Because the Supreme Court has a very strong opinion about the merit-based, about the merit. And if the reservation exceeds beyond the 50%, then the concept and the principle of the merit gets diluted. And that is where it hinges on. So Arun Jaitley has clarified in the court, I'm completely out of the word, that it is erroneous on his part too.
Aishwarya Bhatti, do you agree with the finance minister that in this particular case, the 50% doesn't hold because it's not caste-based?
So far, the scrutiny that was there for the Supreme Court was indeed caste-based reservation. And Ashutosh ji is right in pointing out that in Indira Sahni, the Supreme Court did not agree with the economically backward being a criteria for reservation. But I must add there, it's just half truth. The full truth is that so far the Constitution did not have a provision for having economically weaker as a criteria for reservation. That is why this exercise that we see that has started today is introducing an amendment in the Constitution. In fact, it's not going to. Manisha ji, you know, has all the details of statistics.
But
I only have the legal details.
Ms. Aishwarya, but I'm a lawyer. You should know that amendment can also be reviewed by the Supreme Court.
Can I please complete, ma'am? Can I please complete?
That amendment can also be reviewed by the Supreme Court.
Can I please complete my point?
And then I'll bring you in, Pallavi. Allow Aishwarya to finish speaking.
Can I please complete my point?
Did I interrupt? The government will drop in an amendment. The Supreme Court.
Okay, one second. Pallavi Sharma, one second. Allow Aishwarya to finish speaking.
I did not interrupt you. You have your area, ma'am. Don't worry. You will have your time.
One at a time, please. One at a time.
You will have your time. See, we are professionals. See, Manisha ji, you and I are two professionals. We are not political parties that we need to interject each other like this.
That's Pallavi Sharma. Okay. One second. Everybody, just one second. Let's take a breath.
The point that I'm making,
Aishwarya ji,
is
the person who spoke just now was Pallavi Sharma and not Manisha Priyam. Pallavi Sharma is with the Congress party. Now, Aishwarya will finish making her point and then Pallavi will be allowed a rebut. Go ahead, Aishwarya.
Yeah, so the point that I was making was that, you know, so far there has been no foundation in the Constitution to have any reservation for economically weaker sections. That is why an amendment that is being proposed, this exercise we are seeing is an amendment in Article 15 and Article 16 of the Constitution so that there is a foundation available for states. Remember, the reservation will be made by the states and they will decide what is the economic criteria. What is the threshold that should be there for each of those states? So that is a second exercise. The law will come in later. This is only a constitution amendment. Sorry, I did not know who was interjecting. But yes, constitutional amendment can also be challenged. And I'm sure it will be challenged. It will have to pass the muster of the Supreme Court also. But as of now, we can't judge economic reservation on the basis of the principles that are laid down in Indira Sahni's judgment.
Pallavi Sharma, rebuttal, please.
This will have to meet its own, pass its own muster independently.
Ms. Aishwarya just contradicted herself. She said states will decide. And then you have the finance minister saying that the 50% ratification that's allowed to the states will not hold in this case. So I think the BJP first has to come clear whether the states have a role to play or they don't have a role to play. Second, the point I was making was that this government should stop misleading the people of this country by saying that they are going to make a constitutional amendment, which was not done by the Narasimha Rao government. Hence, the Supreme Court overruled it by passing the Indira Sahni judgment in 92. My point is this, even if you bring a constitutional amendment, which the finance minister claims his government will, the Supreme Court can still review that constitutional amendment and you will still have to pass the scrutiny of the law. You cannot bypass it.
But Pallavi Sharma, before we wrap up, a quick question for you. Now, the Congress has said, and you said you support the bill, but you want it referred to a select committee. Now, if it is not referred to a select committee and Lok Sabha votes and Rajya Sabha votes, will the Congress vote for or against the bill?
See, the Congress party has very categorically said what its stand is. They support economic reservation for the weaker sections. For the economically weaker sections, we... Sir, please allow me to finish. It's the classic example that we saw in triple talaq case. The Congress party supported that triple talaq should be abolished. But your government came up with such a poorly drafted bill, with a two-page bill. You reduced a 490-page judgment to a two-page bill and you wanted the Congress party to support it. Same is the case here. We are in complete favor for EWS quota, but the point is the government has to say has to be legally solid on it. The government has to
have
more detailed guidelines for which they need to refer it to a select committee. Why don't you send it to a select committee? Only because you want to derive political benefit out of it.
That's
entitled, but you will not refer it to a select committee.
The main skill of a politician is debate.
He wants to take it to the next session.
Political discourses become very disappointing.
He can...
I mean, much as we would want to criticize the BJP, the fact is that even for the Congress, if they are so upset with this bill, they should just say we'll vote against it, right?
Yes.
I mean, ultimately, to make all this noise and go ahead and support the bill and vote for it is hypocrisy of another order. You really can't do that. If you have such a problem with this bill, don't vote for it. But the fact is they will.
It's like our colleague Mandar made a joke a little while ago saying there should be a new category for emotionally backward people at this point. But Ramdas Atawale is making a statement. He's speaking in Lok Sabha. We're just going to cut across to listen into what he has to say.
नरेंद्र मोदी जी का था अच्छा लक्षण नरेंद्र मोदी जी का था अच्छा लक्षण इसलिए मिल रहा है सवर्णों को आरक्षण राहुल गांधी नहीं नरेंद्र मोदी जी ही कर रहे हैं देश का रक्षण राहुल गांधी नहीं नरेंद्र मोदी जी ही कर रहे देश का रक्षण 2019 में कांग्रेस का हो जाएगा भक्षण राहुल जी मोदी जी के साथ मत खेलो गलत चाल राहुल जी मोदी जी के साथ मत खेलो गलत चाल नहीं तो तुम्हारा बहुत हो जाएगा 2019 में बुरा हाल राफेल का मत फैलाओ जानबूझकर जाल राफेल का मत फैलाओ हमारे सामने जाल राफेल का मत फैलाओ हमारे सामने जाल नरेंद्र मोदी ही जीतेंगे 2019 का साल